That's the beginning of a party right
Welcome,
there.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to this fine radio program, podcast, and video extravaganza known internationally as the world-famous Smoking and Toasting. Welcome. It's show number 253. We are all about craft beer, fine spirits, and hand-rolled cigars, and we'll be talking a lot of cigars today because we are at one of Houston's finest smoking establishments.
Oldest smoking establishment.
Yep, that's right. That's right. We are at the Briar Shop, which is in the Rice Village area in Houston, and this is our first time to broadcast from here, so it's I'm really excited about
it. I've been coming
here.
Up to the shop for years now. One of the owners will be joining us in a little one of the later segments here, so we'll get to talk to him about a little bit of the history of the place and things like that, too.
Well, I know if you're a pipe smoker, this is like a number
it's
one
the place,
on your
yeah.
list.
It's
yeah,
the
because
place.
They have got they've got not only an amazing selection of pipes, but a wide variety of tobaccos. I was resisting the urge as I was over with the pipe tobacco to just open them all one by one and take a big, you know, take a big.
You know, so we've done a few pipe shows in the past, but one of my go-to tobaccos is the Accountant, which they sell here. It's one of their aromatic blends that I absolutely love.
So I saw one called the Detective, and that has me curious.
You got some great ones. They got one called,
see what you did there.
They got one called Old Bookstore, too.
I like.
Like, I want to buy that just for the name.
Yeah, some of them are really, it's worth it just for the name. Well, we have not introduced our guest. If you're a regular on the show, you may know him already. He's been with us before. He's one of our favorite guests, which we only say about
Every guest.
But he is
no,
one of
this
our
guy seriously
that.
Rocks.
Trenton Smith from Oliva Cigars is here. We have a lot of Oliva stuff to talk about. And he has also brought along a whiskey, which we'll be getting to a little bit later on in the show. So, but we are live. The show emanates from Houston, Texas, although it's heard all the way around the world. And we are officially doing our first broadcast from the Briar Shop, so it's a good historic day. Ian, I see you dressed up for the occasion. I like that.
Well, so every time Trenton comes on, he always dresses so well. So I had to go. I had to up my shirt a little bit.
We call him the anti-docs. That's what we call him. He's like the opposite of docs. He always dresses up. Docs always comes in like flip flops,
like your Hawaiian shirt and everything else.
Yeah, exactly. So
now I figure my boss is my. Someday see this, so I want them. I want them to see
you
I actually dress
know.
Up once in a while.
Well, bosses, if you're watching, this guy is the goods. We love Trenton. We're so glad to have you back here for show number 253. We are brought to you by MyCigarShirts.com. Great shirts for cigar lovers on the web. We're getting inching closer to the holiday season. You may want to pick something up for any friends or cigar smokers that are on your gift list. MyCigarShirts.com because...
Cigars,
yes. So, Ian, this is worth mentioning that Tuesday was not only my birthday, and by the way, thanks for remembering. Ian handed me a nice little package of goodies before the show started. Thank you.
Happy birthday.
Thank you. And Trenton's already given me some gifts here, so you're participating as well. But Tuesday was not only my birthday, but it was also National Drink Beer Day. Coincidence? I don't think so. So we'll be drinking some beer today.
And you know what? I think I heard that today is National Podcast Day.
Is that true?
I saw that somewhere.
You know,
if not, it is now.
It is now. That's right.
No, I saw that and I'm like, that's pretty funny.
It doesn't matter what you do. There's a National Tiddlywinks Day, for God's sake. So there's...
I'm going to Google that.
Yeah, try it. Look it up. Look it up. I'm telling you. So anyway, we will be tasting some beers today. St. Arnold has a new one that I must admit that I have already tried, and I can't wait for you to try it, Ian. It's a hazy pale ale called Harmony. And, of course, St. Arnold is so consistent.
Well, you're all about the safety factor. I was actually commenting earlier on how generally when you bring a bottle, like for instance, see, I was
the
showing Trenton this.
The blue label,
so
the
when you bring the bottle here, you notice there's no plastic left on here, and you've cleared the neck, so you don't have to worry about any... rum spillage,
right? Exactly, and then
at all,
and in the case of those plastic
and Trenton, who
I didn't know,
he only comes on here part time, had no idea. So this right. bottle actually has plastic and the ability to spill a little bit if I open it a little too fast.
Next time,
open with great care because, as I think has been documented, those plastic things can give you a nasty little plastic version of a paper cut.
Ooh. It's a plastic cut.
A plastic cut, exactly. So. Okay. So we'll be trying those out. We'll also be tasting, in addition to the St. Arnold Harmony, Hazy Pale Ale. We'll be trying out the Demon King of Friday. It is an American wild ale.
That
from
sounds
the ale
appropriately dramatic.
Yes, it does.
Seems like we should be drinking that a little closer to Halloween.
Well, we've got there's so much Halloween themed stuff coming, and after all, tomorrow's October, so they've only been selling
Halloween stuff for like 3 months now.
Oh yeah, they sell Christmas trees now.
Yeah, you can't even find Halloween stuff. It's all Christmas trees. So, and then last but certainly not least, from Other Half Brewing Company in Brooklyn, New York, we'll be trying their Deep Orbit Centaurus. It's an Imperial Stout with vanilla, figs, almonds, and cinnamon.
You were speaking my language there.
I had a feeling you were going to be into that. So
those are all things
all of that to try. A lot of great stuff on the show. We will, of course, be doing our segment that has just become completely mystifyingly popular called Drinking News.
Can we hold that just a moment?
Our Drinking News live headline. Our teaser headline. For Drinking News, this particular edition is, that homeless guy looks familiar. So we'll be getting to that on the show as well. Plus,
that is actually something I've said before.
It's not first. Good. Cigars are booming. In fact, I'm going to go ahead and say this. If no one else has said it, I'll be the first. I think we're in another cigar boom right now. Cigar boom 2.0. Imports of cigars to the United States are up huge in 2021. Huge. So we'll talk about that a little and what reports are telling us, plus how you can drink beer and raise money for Hurricane Ida relief with Urban South Brewery. You can drink beer and raise money for a good cause, that's
And Urban South makes great beer.
They really do. So we have all of that, a lot of good stuff coming on, and Trenton with Oliva is here, plus we'll be talking to the guys who run this establishment here at the Briar Shop and finding out the history of Houston.
I want to also point out that Trenton not only has a fantastic sport coat on, but the most fun socks.
Oh yeah, just for the show.
Like socks. These socks have martini glasses and shakers and olives all over them.
I love it.
So long time ago, my wife and daughter didn't know what to get me for birthday, Christmas. So now every birthday, Christmas, Father's Day, it's socks.
I love it. As long as they're decorative and fun and exciting.
Oh, that's
like
right.
Yeah.
Socks, I don't think, are a bad thing. Like, they get a bad rap, but you know, when's the last time you went out and got excited and shopped for socks yourself?
But my doctor.
Every now and then I do.
My doctor has me wearing these long and very tall support socks.
Are they bamboo?
No, but they feel like it sometimes. Because they really constrict your legs to help the blood flow.
I've heard a lot about bamboo.
To your extremities. But the only thing about it is, during the summertime here in Houston, of course, I wear shorts most of the time. So shorts with these long, tall black socks, the only thing missing for me...
Oh, that's a look.
...is a metal detector.
That's a...
You know?
Yeah.
That's the only thing missing to complete the look.
You're officially an old man
I am officially an old man.
I want to...
Add in a cigar.
I want to point something out here. This beautiful book. Look, it comes in a cigar-like box case here. This beautiful book that Trenton's given us. I opened this up earlier. What was it? Page 65?
56, I think it was.
Hold on. Let me get around to this, because this has... Yeah, if you don't mind holding that, I'll... there we go.
It's like a Cosmo quiz.
I'm going to bring this over to the thing. Remember, I just said that, most people don't feel like they really want to... I'll give this to you. I'll let you put it up to the camera there. They don't want to go sock shopping. You said, well, sometimes I do. The way you hold that cigar, I believe, on that page comes out as... Quirky, because there's a whole page of the way you hold your cigar says
like
something about you. No, it's with the finger
like
curled over the top.
Curled over the top. Okay. Quirky. What about...
I hope my wife never listens to this show.
Does it say in there when you hold a cigar like this what that would mean?
Just don't.
Okay. Fair enough.
Just stop.
Fair enough. Mm. All right. So Trenton, the last time you were on the show, an amazing thing happened.
It was the day of...
Breaking news.
Yes, it was.
Breaking news.
I remember that day.
We were talking about the basic fact that Oliva, for being one of the leading, boutique cigar companies in the world, and one of our personal favorites, how you guys don't come up with a new release like every other day.
It's not very often.
Yeah, right. Now, I love Rocky Patel, but Rocky puts out a new cigar what seems like every month. I mean, and he does great work. I'm not knocking the concept, but we were talking about what is one of the things I found interesting about Oliva is that you guys don't release new cigars very often. When you do, it's really an event. And during that same show, we were having that discussion, unbeknownst to Ian and myself, Trenton announced a brand new Oliva cigar. In fact, you just got the email of the announcement of it.
I got a text from
my
boss.
On that show,
yeah.
Right? Or yep. You got a text. And so we've been talking about and anticipating this cigar. It actually comes out in
October at some point.
October at some point, so yep. You have not put a date on it.
Correct.
But I can show it to you because Trenton brought some of these, and I'll actually walk up. I don't even know where the.
Look how free you are with that wireless. I know what's going on over here.
Well, you know, I had to step up my game.
You feel untethered.
I was shamed into it by certain people who. But this is it. This is the new Oliva cigar. And Trenton, tell us. It says 135 on the band that's around the foot of the cigar. It's got, of course, the Oliva Serie V thing, and it is tapered. It's a figurado, right?
It's a perfecto.
It's a perfecto. Yep. Okay. So it's kind of like a reverse torpedo, basically. It's tapered more towards the foot, and it is thicker towards the head of the cigar.
Looks kind of like a baseball bat.
Where did this particular one come from, and what is it all about?
Okay, so this is the 135th anniversary for the Oliva family, and that dates all the way back to Cuba.
135 years.
135.
Wow. 135
going all the way back to Melanio Oliva, who started the whole Oliva tobacco family. And he primarily grew in the Pinar del Rio region of Cuba, which is a very famous region. Mm-hmm. It wasn't even known as that back then. And his son, Facundo, carried
That's
on.
That's easy for you to say.
I know. I had to be careful saying that.
He didn't get teased at school at all, I'm sure.
Not back then. So Facundo took over the legacy, and then Gilberto, mm-hmm. Took over from him,
who we know from
the Gilberto mm-hmm. cigar mm-hmm. line, and his son, Jose, recently our owner and president, and now we're owned by Jay Cortez. So 135 years of Oliva cigar history, dating all the way back to 1886, and this cigar is a tribute to that. It's beautiful packaging, and it is a Serie V. It's just a different shape and size, and there's only 15,000 boxes made. And they come in 12-count boxes. Just a gorgeous presentation.
Yeah.
Now, the best part is, it's going to retail for $10 a cigar.
Are you
that
kidding me?
That is unbelievable.
Yeah.
See, this is one of the things we love so much about Oliva Cigars is it would be quite understandable if the top cigars in your line were $15 to $20 cigars.
Yeah.
And yet, you guys have a tendency to keep your prices so reasonable. In fact, you mentioned Gilberto Oliva, his namesake cigars. I just bought a box of those last month, and they're a nice. I think is it a Long Toro? Is that what you call it?
We've got a Toro Churchill. We've got a Robusto.
This must be the Churchill because it's a longer cigar. So I bought a box of those, and they are so affordable. I don't know if I can think of another cigar at that price point that comes anywhere close to being as good as those cigars are.
Yeah, it's a phenomenal cigar. And when we came out with it, I thought, you know, are we doing justice to Gilberto by making a cigar that isn't an expensive cigar?
That's got his name on it,
right? It's got his name on it. But that was Gilberto. Anybody that knew him knew that he had a passion for tobacco, for cigars, and making them available, readily available to the public without breaking the bank.
And I tell you, again...
Well, you guys are absolute proof that you don't have to spend insane amounts of money to get a fantastic cigar.
Well, that's absolutely true.
I've said it.
If you're somebody that smokes on a regular basis... I mean, if you smoke a cigar or two a day, those $10, $15, $20 cigars
That adds up pretty quick.
So,
and I'll tell you, like Oliva can sometimes. I don't think about it so much because it's always there, but I always have some in my humidor. I always have the Serie V, at least one Melanio, and then Nubs. Nubs are the best cigars ever to just keep in your pocket. Especially in the Tubo.
And you love the big ring gauge cigars.
I do love big
anyway,
ring,
so
ring
nubs
cigars,
are perfect. Yeah. And it looks like something that would be a quick smoke, but as we've talked about here
it's
on
not.
The show before,
no.
It's not at all, even though it's short. And you have mentioned this also before, but you love the one in the Tubo because you can just tuck it into
so
a shirt pocket.
It's so easy to toss it in your pocket. You don't worry about it. You can travel around. Even if you're wearing jeans, you can toss it in your jean pocket. It doesn't get crunched up. And it's such a nice, and if you don't smoke it, don't worry about
it.
Yeah,
right.
You know, just still in the two low, toss it back in the humidor, you're good.
Absolutely.
Love those. I love the whole line.
Well, I'm very excited. I am going to smoke this one on the show, even though there's a part of me that really wants to save it. I was thinking, what could be a more special occasion than this?
And these came right off the floor at the show, and I don't have any more.
Okay. Well, we feel honored, and we'll talk about it. We'll see what, you know, how it strikes us, and pass this information along.
Well, I thought it only fitting since we broke the news on the show.
I'm going to have Adam show this picture. This is me smoking a nub at my brew
fantastic.
Club meeting, right?
That is a great photo.
This is the entire cigar ash.
And he's not even holding it upside down.
Adam will show that to the
camera.
That
is standing straight out while I'm smoking it.
Yeah. Can you show that to the camera?
Is my camera doing a weird thing again? Uh-oh.
Uh-oh.
Did you get the box on there also?
Yes.
Cool.
Well, we're really honored to be able to sample this. And tell me again, how many of these were produced?
15,000 boxes.
And is that limited amount because it was there was a limited amount of some of the tobacco that goes into it? Is it limited on purpose to keep it more special?
It's limited on purpose. Okay. To make it special, we just wanted a tribute cigar, put it out there, and be done with it.
I love it. It's a really cool thing. And, you know, one of the reasons that I kind of got started smoking cigars is I used to collect all kinds of things. I used to collect, you know, DVD movies and comic books and all kinds of, you know, magazines, all kinds of. And that
these sound like things that you can all put on an iPad now.
Well, that crap takes up a lot of space. CDs, yes. I had a room full of CDs, right? I don't have any of that anymore. And the only thing I collect now is cigars because they have a tendency to, you know, you burn them and then they're gone and you have to replace the collection. But no, I love the collectible or the rare or limited edition cigars, especially when they're not like ridiculously priced, which clearly, did you say
$10? $10 a,
that's
$10 per cigar.
Unbelievable. Yeah.
I mean, especially because everything seems to be getting so expensive in the world of cigars and spirits. And
are they coming in boxes of 10? Is that what I saw?
No, a box of 12.
Box of 12, yeah.
And it's a beautiful box,
that's going to be a box I buy immediately. Well,
yeah. Better get them quick.
Be looking forward to that. Wanted to mention,
I know a guy.
If you are in the greater Houston area, there's an event going on this weekend that is put on by our buddy Chris Hart, who is the program's ongoing whiskey expert.
Yes.
We didn't name him that. That was somebody else gave him
that. That was Texas Monthly, actually.
Texas Monthly. But Chris and his company, the same guys that do the Whiskey Social every year, they have an event coming this weekend in Houston at the comedy show. It's a vintage whiskey comedy showcase. And they've got a lineup of comics who are going to, you know, perform and do their comedy stuff. And apparently, all for the ticket price, you get a chance to sample some vintage whiskeys as well.
And it's going to be held at the same venue as the Whiskey Social.
Is that where it is?
Yes, I believe it's at the Citadel, just south of town off 288.
Well, I am really looking forward to it. I will be there, but I wanted to make sure we gave one last chance because it's coming up in a couple of days. So if you're in the greater Houston
area, that's on Saturday.
You should come check it out because it's been too long since we all got together in a room and laughed their asses off.
I didn't even know comedy was still legal.
it's not in many states because, you know, it's thought of as being very subversive these days. You know, so it's returning to that anyway. It used to be that, you know, comics were the ones who could get away with pretty much anything. You know what I mean? They could say stuff that was very edgy and it would be, I mean, I guess back in the day, you know, Lenny Bruce got in some trouble and some of those kind of things. Yeah. But for the most part, for the last, you know, 20, 25 years, comics were able to be pretty much edgier than anyone else. And I think
there's more than rock stars a lot of times.
Absolutely. Because it was all for laughs.
Yeah, it was comedy.
But these days it has gotten a little, everybody seems to have gotten a little more touchy.
I would be interested in seeing what the comedy actually looks like today because you can't offend people.
Well, sure you can. That's part of what comedy
is. I know that's
is.
What comedy is, but you can't do that today.
Yeah, I don't know. Well,
you got to be PC.
We'll find out at the Vintage Whiskey Comedy Showcase.
Oh, that'll be fun.
And I have the feeling that the more whiskey is consumed, the less anybody's going to be worried about being offended, really. That's, at least that's the way I look at it. But
except
know,
for that one guy. There's always that one guy.
Always one guy.
Yeah, don't be that guy. That'd be a good shirt. There's always one guy. Don't be that guy.
I was about to tip the ash on this nub, and then I realized I probably don't have to.
You probably don't. In fact, I've seen evidence that you don't have to.
And, if you don't see that guy around you, you might be that
guy. You might be that guy. Yeah.
If you don't know that guy.
That's right. All right, we're going to take a break and come back and do a little tasting and sampling here, and I will be lighting up this brand new Oliva.
Boy.
So this is called, tell me the name of this again.
That's
the exact name of the cigar.
The exact cigar is the Oliva Serie V 135th anniversary limitada, and it's a Perfecto size.
And this is the only size it's available.
This is the only size.
All right, I'm looking forward to lighting that up. We'll get to that in a few moments, and we'll be right back. You are listening to and watching Smoking and Toasting. It's all about craft beer, fine spirits, and hand-rolled cigars, and we'll be right back. Welcome back. It is Smoking and Toasting. This is the program. It's all about craft beer, fine spirits, and hand-rolled cigars. We are live at the Briar Shop in the Rice Village area of Houston. Our guest today is Trenton from Oliva Cigars, and we are brought to you by the fine folks at MyCigarShirts.com. Great shirts for cigar lovers on the web, MyCigarShirts.com, because...
Cigars.
Yes. And by the way, we're having a little, a minor issue with the transmission of the show on video today. Apparently a couple of times during that last segment
it has purpled out.
The screen turned purple for a couple of seconds.
Yeah, so if that happens again, please stand by, because we'll swap iPads and then repost the show, and you'll be able to join us then.
Yeah, we got to get this fixed. I need my bosses to see that I dress up.
Yeah, okay, exactly. Well, it's purple. You got a nice blue jacket on, so it'll work. I was going to say that should it turn purple again, that if you're able to share the show to more than 100 people while the purple is still on, we'll come up with a very special prize for you.
There you go.
So, you know, so be watching for the purple.
It will be special.
Yeah. Speaking of special, this special new limitada, the Oliva Serie V 135th anniversary, I'm probably not saying it exactly right.
That's right.
Limitada in a Perfecto size is the cigar that's coming out at some point in the next 30 days. This is going to be on the shelves of your local tobacconist.
Sometime in October.
But there's not many. There's not many of them, because there's only 15,000 boxes being created. So if you want one, you're going to have to snag one or snag a box as soon as you see it, because they won't. I'm betting they'll all be gone by Christmas.
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay. All right. So make sure you find it. I'm going to smoke this one here in just a moment, and we'll let you know what our first impressions of it are. But my guess is it's going to be pretty darn good. Ian is pouring our first beer. This is a new one from St. Arnold. It is called Harmony, and it is a hazy pale ale. Not an India pale ale, but a hazy pale ale. You can see it's a little bit lighter in color, and the can is particularly interesting, I thought.
It has the classic St. Arnold stylings, but it also has a little more kind of fun looking colors and scheme on there.
I just love the nose on this thing. It is so citrusy and so bright, and it's got it gives the promise of a very easy to drink pale ale.
Now, you've tried this before,
I have.
I will admit.
What
are your thoughts on it?
I was actually pretty blown away by it. It is, I will tell you that at this moment, it has taken over Artcar as my favorite St. Arnold product. I like it even better than their Juicy IPA. I think it's
substantially better than Artcar.
This is just a deliciously balanced, it's a little bit lighter, it's very citrusy, and it just has that perfect balance that keeps it from being, you get a sense of the hops, but it does not give you a hop bitter sting on the end.
No,
it doesn't linger.
It has a crisp finish without a ton of bitter, a nice round finish. And the interesting enough, it has a bigger mouthfeel than I was expecting as well from a, what are they calling this, a hazy pale ale,
yes.
Pale ale, you expect to be a little thinner overall mouthfeel, and this has a much more substantial, you can even kind of see it when you're looking down in it, mouthfeel to it.
You know, what's interesting to me about St. Arnold is they have gone from being a brewery that doesn't add too many things to their core line. They had a basic core line, and then they would come out with special limited releases.
Yeah, and I love all their seasonals.
And they've kind of changed that up. The seasonals still come and go. The Oktoberfest, in my opinion, is one of the best Oktoberfests I've had. And the you know, winter beer. What is the winter St. Arnold? I always forget now, the title of it off the top of my head. But that's,
oh, well, they have the Christmas ale now.
The Christmas ale,
the,
yeah.
The winter stout as well.
Right. Both of which are terrific.
Yes,
but what they've begun to do is just release more new beers that are added to their line. When you go in to the St. Arnold section at your favorite beer shop or even at the grocery store, you can see there's just so many different cans, so many different things to try, and they really excel, I think, at all of them. I mean, everything in their line, I think, is terrific. I'm just have my fingers crossed that one holiday season they're going to bring back the Sailing Santa.
The Sailing Santa.
I love that. Sailing Santa was a blend of their Christmas ale and the Alyssa IPA, and it was wonderful. And I've tried, by the way, blending it myself, and it's just not as good. It's just not the same.
Sailing Santa sounds like something you'd see in Margaritaville.
Yeah, it does. And it kind of had that vibe to it, you know? It really did. But anyway.
I want to point out that I'm smoking this Nub Connecticut here, and it goes really well with this.
Yeah. Yeah, it's, you know, as a person that is a fan of IPAs, some of my very favorites, Stone and Dogfish Head and some of the things that are just such big and wonderfully bold IPAs, just really don't work with cigars.
Yeah,
I have to find times to drink them when I'm not having a smoke.
Before the show, I was next door having lunch over at Torchy's, and they had Ghost in the Machine on tap, and so I had one of those.
God bless you, Torchy's.
Early start.
That is a wonderful, wonderful beer. It really is.
He texted me at like, or I texted him, and he texted back at like 11:20.
Yeah.
And I was still in Clear Lake, and he goes, "Yeah, I'm already here." I go, "I'm supposed to be here at 12:45, right?" He goes, "Yeah, I'm just excited."
You know how you lose a lot of, when you have a text, you lose a lot of the emotion of what
the context
the text is
of
about.
It. Yeah.
Context,
right.
You know, contextual emotion, if you will. But I got that when he's like, "I'm supposed to be there at 12:45, right?"
No, it was just a moment of panic. I'm like, I didn't get my times wrong.
I should have let you on. I should have been like,
we're going on air.
We're starting in 5 minutes. Yeah. you guys, if you don't mind, talk amongst yourself. I'm gonna get ready to light this cigar up.
Don't forget to take that footer off, or it's gonna taste like paper.
Your mic is off.
Oh, I'm not even talking.
I have to remember to keep turning that on. Nobody's heard anything I've said.
Just the last sentence.
Are you losing battery there? Or?
No. I muted it because I don't have a switch on my mic.
Ah, gotcha.
Because I lost that mic, so I just had to grab another one.
Right, How do you lose a mic?
I have a lot of mics.
Okay. I use cigar scissors on this. I did not bring my punch with me today, which would have been my preferred way to do this. But I use cigar scissors to clip off the cap. Now I'm going to take this little band off the bottom and light this baby. I'm very excited for this cigar.
So. I want to know how that is.
I think I'm going to join you.
Oh, I love it. I love it.
Now, see, that's dedication. He's putting out setting down a perfectly good cigar to light up another perfectly good cigar.
Hey, you know what? I'll double fist for a while.
Me, I'm going to smoke this one. This one's not going to last too much longer. I'll get 35 minutes out of this.
Well, I got to preface that one. We are trained professionals, so don't try this at home.
Yes, there is that. Actually,
do try this at home.
Okay,
yeah,
I like that.
Yeah, you know?
Just don't forget when you have a lit cigar, don't put it in your pocket while you light another one. That can end up bad. So I'm super excited about it.
That's the way it goes.
Yeah.
Adam thought I had the cigar back.
It looks
like
it, right?
It looks like it'd be that. Well, so a Perfecto is usually tapered on both ends. This Perfecto is not tapered on the cap side of it, on the head of it.
All right. I'm going to have to borrow a lighter.
I have one right here, sir.
Oh, thank you. Okay. Now, I want to do this sidecar lighter.
It's about 100 years old.
And I want to know how you did it, because I have one of these, and I've had to send it back for a replacement 3 times.
Really?
They've happily replaced it, but mine just kept.
I find Zycar to be pretty good about it. This is my third of this, of my previous one that I had. I have the third one of that, and they've been so gracious about just giving me a new one every single time. I bought this one that the clip actually sticks magnetically to it, and that makes me super happy.
I will say, though, they did change their policy. Because it used to be that when you needed to change out one of these, you could just take it to the cigar store where you
and
bought it.
And they took care of it.
And they would just swap you for a new one. They'd send it back. Now you have to get a little more involved.
You have to fill out a paper.
Fill out some paper.
You know what, across most boards. Because I, Calibri years ago, I had actually about four or five different Calibri lighters, and they were not cheap. They were pretty nice lighters. And originally, I would send them back. If something happened to it, I'd just send it to them. They'd send me either a replacement or fix the one and send it back and no problems. And then quite a few years back, I guess they changed their policy, or the company sold, I think is what happened. Mm-hmm. And I called them and I said, hey, I have like three Calibri lighters that don't work. And I'd like to see about, you know, sending them back and getting them fixed or whatever. And the first thing the lady says, well, have you ever used anything other than Calibri fluid in it?
Oh, yeah, they're so big on that.
And I said, you know what? If that's the way you're going to treat me, I simply will never buy another product from you. And I just threw those lighters away and called it a day.
I've seen that they're really big on that. It's like, that's, A, the way they try to sell you their butane, their lighter fluid, and, B, it's a way for them to get out of replacing the lighter.
Can you imagine if a car company was like, did you put Toyota gas in your vehicle? I mean, come on, for real?
Okay, so let me give you some initial thoughts on this. First of all, I was expecting the number one hit single by Ian's band, Nicaraguan Pepper Blast, to kind of light me up at the beginning. Did not get that. It starts out nice and I almost said the word mellow, but that's not really the.
I'd say refined.
Yeah, it's very refined. That's good, and it does.
For those of you watching, I just want to point out that there's a couple words you're not supposed to say when you're reviewing a cigar or a whiskey. You're not supposed to say smooth.
Right.
And you're especially not supposed to say mellow.
Right.
Because that's way too catchphrase either
way. Right,
either
right.
Way.
And well, and mellow also implies that it's a really super light cigar, which it's not. It's got plenty of body to it. It's got already a very nice, and you can see I'm not even, what, that about a quarter inch into that? And already a very nice complexity of flavors. It's
Trenton, how do you describe the flavor on this cigar?
Just perfect.
All right.
I hope the boss is watching, because that was the perfect answer.
We got two syllables out of him. That was awesome.
But you know, everybody tastes something different.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
I mean, I can tell people what to taste, but they're going to taste their own
thing.
There's
great earthiness, some notes of like oak and wood that I'm getting in the first. And again, I'm not even a half an inch into this, so this will deepen out, I think. And plus, this part of the cigar is actually much smaller. There's going to be more tobacco.
Yeah, you're
going to
get a burst of flavor when it hits about here.
That's what I'm guessing, yeah. You'll also notice how wonderfully straight that burn is. I have a feeling this is going to be a very well-constructed cigar all the way through.
Fantastic. So are you going to smoke the cigar on the show? Or?
Yes, as soon as I'm done with this.
All right. Mm-hmm.
I started on the lighter side. I'm going to go to that after this.
Yeah, that's usually what we try to do with the beers, except when Ian brings them, in which case we open up with
well, the lighter side may be 9%.
Yeah, with a 9% wee heavy and go upward from there. But this is really wonderful. And I will say that this is actually working rather well with the St. Arnold Pale Ale as well. Nice little citrus tang on my tongue. I don't know if it was from the beer, if I'm picking up any of it from this cigar, but
well, I'm going to be honest. I picked up this. You put a couple cigars in front of us, and I picked up this Nub Connecticut. I never smoked these. I smoked the Maduros. Like when I go to grab cigars, I almost always grab the Maduros because that's just the flavor profile I generally like. And it's not that I don't like other cigars. Right. I naturally gravitate towards the.
I'm the same way.
Darker wrappers, and so it was fun for me to go, oh, I'm going to have this.
Mm-hmm. Try something new.
And just something a little different.
It's always interesting to me to change up. You know, I have a tendency to smoke mostly Nicaraguan cigars, mostly medium to full. And so whenever I change up and go with something, you know, lighter or something with a really different profile, it's pretty interesting trying to detect the flavors on the palate that are a little bit different from what I would normally smoke. And I'm sure that's what's happening with the Nub Connecticut.
Well, this is definitely milder on the strength, but definitely full of flavor. It's, mm-hmm. The nice thing about a good Connecticut is it can be a mild cigar and have still a really nice big flavor to it.
Yeah.
That fills the palate and doesn't leave you feeling like you just, you know, had a Bud Light.
I wanted to point out, by the way, that, you know, I usually have my iPad set up here with some notes for the show, and if I need to refer to an article or a list of some sort. But I just had a text roll in. Apparently, AT&T had some sort of an outage. They've sent me a text apologizing for it, and it says, here's a little gift for you. And if I click on the link, and in fact, they even personalized it. They said, sorry about the recent outage, Thomas.
Yes.
So if you've been getting those like I have, like every day for the past 3 weeks, do not click on them, folks. That's that's another phishing expedition.
The scams have been so bad lately.
They really have.
So
our friends at Urban South Brewing in Louisiana have come up with a wonderful idea. They're raising funds for Hurricane Ida victims, and they're still putting things back together in New Orleans and parts of Louisiana from Hurricane Ida. Even though we were very lucky here in Houston and didn't get any more than a little bit of rain, there was quite a bit of devastation. So Urban South has launched a new benefit in order to raise funds for those who were impacted by the hurricane. It was actually one of the most powerful storms in regional history. And they are donating $1 from every six-pack purchased at the tap room or in stores, as well as a percentage of pint sales at bars and restaurants of their Houdat Golden Ale. If you're not from New Orleans or don't know people who live there, Houdat is a pretty famous New Orleans phrase. I don't know if it originated here.
Who is that?
Right.
Is the longer version of that.
Right. But it goes back to chants and stuff that they'll do at the New Orleans Saints football game. The popular one being, Houdat say they're going to beat them Saints. Houdat. Houdat. And that's the way it goes. Anyway, a portion of the proceeds is being donated to the Urban South Coastal Harmony Fund, and they will be rapidly directed to organizations that are doing on-the-ground hurricane relief work in the southern region.
We have an Urban South here in Houston as
well. We do.
Well.
And
so they're expanded regionally.
Yeah, I would imagine that they will be doing the same thing with stuff that comes out of the Houston brewery as well. But I just want to say, they make wonderful beer. And whenever you can drink beer and do a good thing at the same time, that's just double.
That's
goodness.
Like doing a good thing while you're doing a good thing.
Exactly right. Yeah.
It's a double positive.
Which almost sounds like a sitcom, doesn't it? Doing a good thing while you're doing a good thing.
There's got to be a song out there.
Starring a young Will Smith. So anyway, Urban South Houdat Ale. Go check it out because it is a good thing to do. And I haven't had the Houdat Golden Ale, but I will be looking for some. So I can.
We need to call them back. They were on our show almost a year ago now, I bet it was.
Oh, and their beer was so exceptional.
Their beer is so weird because they have so many beers.
Mm-hmm.
But they have a couple core lines that they keep intact as far as I know. When you go into their brewery, you never know what you're going to see.
I was in New Orleans right before the pandemic hit. Went there for a weekend with my wife, and we had a nice dinner at one of the restaurants down in the quarter. And I enjoyed a very wonderful, juicy IPA from Urban South with my dinner. I still remember it going, oh, this is good. So a lot of great breweries in New Orleans. In Louisiana.
Louisiana.
I meant to say Broussard, Louisiana is home to Parish Brewing,
which is
one of my all-time personal favorites. So
they got what's the one with the turtle on it, too? I can't think of the name of it. They have one with a turtle on it and a few others.
There's a number of great ones.
So you mentioned the hurricane relief thing. One of the things about hurricane relief is we tend to, as a populace, you know, we'll do a bunch of things initially for hurricane relief, and then it kind of tapers off. But a lot of times the people that get affected by those are affected for a long time.
That's
they don't get
true.
The relief until months, sometimes years later. Mm-hmm. It's an important, so if that opportunity comes up and you feel for those people, please, you know, keep giving.
I am so impressed with what I'm getting off of this cigar. It is a really balanced and nuanced mix of flavors. It's just really nice on the palate.
And you're just about to
I'm
the
just
point where
about
you're going
to hit the point where it's
going to
come through. Yeah,
the flavor burst.
Yeah. It also smokes nice and slow, which is, this cigar may last me the whole show, it seems like, because it's just smoking nice and slow, but a thick volume. I just saw you with
big
that
volume of smoke.
Big volume of smoke.
And that's a tribute to the Serie V characteristic, the Lajero tobacco that we use in it. Has a lot of oil in it. So,
and so that creates the larger output of smoke.
And a slower burn.
Well, so far, this is performing just wonderfully. I would I would venture to say it's outperforming just about any $10 cigar I could think of. You know,
that's awesome. I'm gonna try mine.
So yeah,
I should be done with this.
I think.
What do you think? I got about 15 minutes left on this.
You know, and that's, you know, you can, if you smoke a little bit slow, you can stretch a nub out for an hour.
They can be amazingly long smoked. As a matter of fact, the Ligero version of it smokes a bit longer overall.
Right, for the reasons we just talked about.
Yes.
Yeah, it absolutely works. Well, this is, I'm getting a little bit of that citrus zest that I talked about is still with me on the palate, kind of tingles on the tongue, which is just a wonderful sensation, and then getting just really rich leather and earth notes on the retrohale too. It's just really, really good. I mean, I didn't expect any less, but still, you love when it pays off,
when it turns out
like
big,
like you were expecting.
The tough question is windy ash, because I'm in. If I were outside, it wouldn't matter, but I'm in somebody's home in the cigar shop. So.
Right, right.
I don't want to ash on the floor.
You know, we went, Ian and his wife, my wife and I, went to the drive-in movie earlier this week.
Wow.
And it was a kind of like a private showing for the people in my building, one of their monthly activities. And I invited Ian and his wife to come along, and they set up a couple of awesome wooden chairs in the back of Ian's pickup. I put the top down on my car. We were sitting there right next to each other, and we were smoking and watching the movie. And I had the same issue about the ash, because I was smoking. Adam actually gave me a Hoya de Monterey cigar for in a little pack for my birthday, and I was smoking it. It was wonderful, and the ash was holding on like crazy, and I was so tempted to do, but I just knew it was going to be all over me. You know, if not, I'd hold it up in the air and the ash would fly over and hit Ian, because he is actually an ash magnet of sorts.
A little bit.
Yeah. So I kept ashing it sooner than I wanted to.
So you're leaving out part of the story.
Yes.
What was the movie?
The movie was Shang-Chi and the Ten Rings.
Oh.
The Marvel movie.
Yeah, it was pretty
good. Which I thought was pretty good, yeah.
I was gonna find a picture, but it took a little too long to find it at the moment. But I actually backed my truck up on the third row at the drive-in theater, so that the bed was facing
the screen,
and then I set up my two lawn chairs and a little folding table in the back of my truck. So we sat up in there, and the weather was perfect, and there was a breeze coming across us.
Yeah, it was nice.
Yeah, it was super.
Any complaints?
No.
Good.
Nice to be able to smoke a cigar and enjoy the movie.
That's fantastic.
That was really cool. Awesome. And I had my Bluetooth radio out there so we could pick up the sound for it and everything.
Yep, I think I'm going to have to ash.
I think you better. So you're smoking a little faster than I am, but not too much.
I'm not talking as much.
Look at that absolute perfection on that burn. That is just wonderful.
Gotta love that.
Yeah.
I'm getting a little too...
This may be headed for my shirt soon, but...
I'm going to go ahead and...
We have taunted you enough.
Yes,
you've all right. Taunted me. So while Ian lights that up, we will take a break and come back for our next segment. We have more beer to taste. And I brought in a whiskey this week, but Trenton apparently has brought a whiskey with him as well. So I'll let you tell us the story of that. Plus, I want to find out a little bit more about the 135-year history of Oliva. And so we'll put you on the spot here
and
ask you some historical Oliva questions. We are all together at the wonderful establishment in Houston, Texas, known as the Briar Shop. And we're smoking and doing a little drinking as well. We'll be right back. Smoking and toasting.
Not toking.
Welcome back. It is Smoking and Toasting. We are live at the Briar Shop in Houston, Texas, and Ian's about to uncork a beer, which is, you know, uncorking a beer is not something that you do every day. Now, I've had this one for a while, so I am, that was nice. That was nice. This is the Ale Apothecary's Demon King of Friday, a wild American ale.
This is an interesting... picture on here. The rest of the label just says Demon King of Friday. It looks like it's going to be fun.
Mm-hmm. Looks pretty dark.
Have a feeling it's going to be a very interesting beer. And it may be dark. You can't tell
if it's the bottle or...
Too dark.
For a wild ale, that is pretty dark. But that's interesting. I've gone ahead and ashed. trying to avoid calamity here.
It's a safe move.
What a wonderful cigar this is. It's just really so nuanced and balanced. It's really a, man, I got to get my hands on some of these when they come out. These are just terrific. Mm-hmm. The latest numbers for the American premium cigar market are showing no sign of cooling. And I said this at the top of the show, but I'm just going to go ahead and pronounce that we are in cigar boom 2.0. Now, the last time we were in a cigar boom, it was great for a lot of people. It was really, that boom was when I sort of discovered and started, you know, smoking cigars.
What year was that?
So this would have been in the 90s, 95 probably, yeah. So what was interesting about it, though, is that there became such a demand for tobacco. And, of course, whoa, you know, tobacco is not something you can take to market, like, immediately. So there became such a demand for tobacco that a lot of cigar companies were having to, you know, roll very young tobacco, put a lot of stuff out that really wasn't aged properly and wasn't up to the standards of what we're now enjoying in the cigar business. So Trenton, if there is another boom, because shipments are up 63.3% for the first 6 months of the year in the United States, that's more than half again what they were last year. Can the cigar industry meet that demand?
Yeah, the industry can meet the demand. The biggest issue now is the supply chain, the shipping issues.
Boxes when, and all of that.
Yeah,
stuff
when
too, yeah.
When we get cargo into the ports, it could sit there for a couple weeks.
Right.
Because they don't have the staff to admit it into the country. Then once it gets admitted, we have to wait on the FDA for approval. I had the same look on my face when I took the first sip.
It's terrific, but woo.
That was a surprise.
So what you're saying is you could ship out a very young cigar, and by the time it gets anywhere, it could be reasonably aged.
Yeah, aged.
You know what? It's like the, what's that whiskey that is
the
boat
Ocean's
aged?
One.
Yeah,
right,
yeah,
right.
Yeah.
The Jefferson makes
so
the Ocean's
So we need to start
one.
Doing that with cigars. Ocean aging.
Yeah. Aged in boxes
that
at the port of
Houston. That could be its own sales pitch, right?
Yeah, I like it. Let's talk about this wild ale. Ian.
Woof.
Wow.
Wild is a good description for this, isn't it?
If you weren't awake before.
It is tart. It's not a classic sour, but it is tart.
No, it's incredibly tart. I'm running out of room over here. It's incredibly tart on it. And it says on the label here, it says, according to the Surgeon General, women should not drink alcoholic beverages
no
during...
No way. Really?
Yeah.
It's like I see that on every beer.
Yeah, they need to really get more imaginative with their...
Bottle fermented with honey and aged in wine barrels. You can definitely taste the wine influence
and
on
you can
that.
Taste the honey, too. As tart as it is, that honey kind of works in tandem with the tartness and keeps it from being just overwhelmingly... you know, it keeps tart from being the only note. You know?
I like tart and sour ales quite a bit, actually. So, so this is right up my alley. This is not what I choose generally to go with a cigar.
Yeah.
There's a little bit of spice that happens in there the back of the palate on this as well. That's very interesting. It kind of lingers like when you have a some kind of pepper infused drink of some sort. You know, there's a little bit of that spice that lingers in the back. That's interesting as well.
It is really a different kind of sensation, though. I mean, this is what I call a party beer, which means it's not one you're going to probably open up, sit at home, and enjoy by yourself. This is one to save until you have friends over, pour a little bit out for everybody, and talk about it.
Yeah, drinking a whole bottle of this by yourself, you're gonna have a look on your face. It's very tart.
Yeah,
but this, you
know,
it's tart
in a sour apple kind of way.
Amazing with this, though, is like a cheesecake with cherries or something like that on top, some kind of thing like that, some kind of dessert thing, because this would offset it very much with the sweetness of a dessert.
It is tart enough that it makes that thing like back behind the edge
little
of your
tickle
jaw.
Little tickle back
there. Yeah, definitely get that. I'm going to say I think it's wonderful, but boy, you have to, I don't know how you prepare for it. You know, I guess what I would say.
It's like jumping in a cold pool.
Wild ales are usually going to have a little bit of a tartness to them, but I wasn't expecting that much tart. That is a lot of tart.
And it's, I definitely get the honey and the wine barrel taste, though, as well. It's not fighting with the cigar. I don't know if I go so far as to say that they go together, but
They're not a match made in heaven.
They're not a match made in heaven, but they're not at war either, which is a good thing. Which is a good thing to go. Because
I would hate to disrupt this. I asked you this last time you were on the show. What do you usually drink if you're going to have a beverage?
Bourbon.
Bourbon.
Yeah, I'm on a big bourbon kick.
Yeah.
My wife says a little too much, but
for me, the easiest companion is rum, because I've yet to find a rum that doesn't go pretty well with just about any
cigar. You'd have to have a pretty bad rum. Right. And as long as you're drinking at a certain level, I think it's pretty easy
and
to match.
Some of them are just, wonderful cigar companions.
Well, especially when you add a little bit of Coke to it.
Yeah.
Right. I'm kidding.
Tequila can be like that, too. Good tequila is pretty easy to pair.
Yes, absolutely. If you get something that's a little younger, where the agave is a little crisper, sometimes it's not quite as good, but if you go with anything that's got a little bit of aging to it, that's got, you know, some of those vanilla and caramel notes to it, it works very, very well with a cigar. And this is a cigar that I think would be great with tequila too.
By the way.
Okay, this is our short segment, so we're going to wrap this up, and we'll be back. We have a whole lot more to go on the show, including drinking news. Our drinking news teaser headline, as you may remember, is. That homeless guy looks familiar.
We're going to have Bill come sit in with us at some point.
Yeah, and talk a little bit more about the
Briar
Shop.
He's not that homeless guy, by the way.
No.
Speaking of homeless.
But we will also be finding out just a little more about the history of Oliva and why this cigar company has made it for 135 years. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
You know? They say what most businesses fail in the first 2 years. They got a little distance on
them. They're grandfathered in a little bit.
Yeah, they are. All right, so we'll be back at Smokin' and Toastin', live from the Briar Shop in Houston, Texas.
Awesome. Right back.
Welcome back. It is Smokin' and Toastin'. For those of you who are on the live feed, we had to change out some equipment, so we are back on a new live feed, and hopefully you guys can find us. For those of you who are watching on YouTube, of course, you won't even know that happened, so... if you're listening to the podcast, of course, it'll all be one continuous thing. So anyway, welcome back. We are live at the Briar Shop in the Rice Village area of Houston, Texas. And Bill from the Briar Shop is with us. How are you, Bill?
I'm fantastic.
Good. How long has the Briar Shop been here?
59 years in existence.
59.
Wow. So you are the oldest tobacconist in Houston.
Was it in this area at first, or did it move here from somewhere else?
Well, so for the last 50 years, we've been in this area within a quarter mile or so. But actually, we started in downtown Houston in a pharmacy across from Kelly's Steakhouse, which was an old, renowned steakhouse in Houston.
Huh.
And when did you move into the Rice Village area?
We moved into Rice Village in 1994. But our place previous to that was 6626 South Main, which was right across from the Scurlock Towers.
Okay. Yep. I know where that is, actually.
So, then just recently you moved, you were just a little further down the strip here. And was that the building you moved into when you moved into the Rice Village?
That is.
Okay, and then moved over to this shop just in the last, 2 years, I think it is?
At the latter part of 2019.
2019, okay, yeah.
You guys are well known as one of the best places in the entire state to shop for pipes and pipe tobacco. Is pipe tobacco as big a part of your business as pipes and pipe tobacco? Is that as big a part of your business as the cigar side, or are cigars a bigger deal?
Cigars are a bigger deal.
Yeah.
But back in the 60s and 70s, every gentleman smoked a pipe.
Right. It was
The humidor at that point in time was just an added source of revenue for the Briar Shop.
Sure.
Since the early 90s and the big cigar boom started taking off, the pipe side has kind of dropped off a little bit, but we've resurrected it in the last 10 years.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of younger gentlemen who are opting for another option for tobacco.
Mm-hmm. We would love to come back here and do a pipe show. We do at least one a year, sometimes more. And your selection of pipes and tobacco is just absolutely terrific.
Yeah, most of the shops that I visit around will have enough pipes to say that they could sell you a pipe, and a couple selections of tobacco, but usually just a few, just because they have so few. But you have kept the pipes in stock. You got a whole bunch. How many different tobaccos do you have just in jars over there?
Probably over 100 loose bulk tobaccos and over 100 different brands of tins.
I don't know anywhere else that has that available where you can just walk in and get it. So that's so interesting. It's so nice because, like, of course, you know, in today's day and age, you can easily go online and order something, but you don't get to try it. You don't get to smell it. You don't get to experience it when you come in here and you have a knowledgeable staff that talks to you about those tobaccos and things like that, and cigars as well, which is super nice. Yeah.
Absolutely. I would say that that we have a cornerstone on knowledge and of the pipes and the cigars and other tobacco products as well.
So you feel like you feel like pipes have kind of begun to be on the upswing a little bit here in the past 10 years?
Absolutely. Yeah. And I think that in large part it's due to the knowledge of the staff. People right. are really interested in finding out what's going on. And so, yes, older gentlemen still smoke pipes, but there's a whole new wave of the younger generation coming in and getting some good knowledge and good products and pipes and tobacco.
Anyone that's got a hipster beard like Ian's looks good with a pipe.
Is that hipster? I don't think my mustache is big enough to be hipster.
Oh, does it have to be more?
I think you have to have more mustache. See Austin.
Yeah, Austin over there's got a great hipster beard. And
we're talking about the beard.
And the hat to go along with it.
Yeah, yeah. So, obviously, you guys do business with, you know, all the major tobacco companies, and their representatives come in here and, you know, make sure you guys have got what you need. How would you rate Trenton as far as the service that he offers to you guys?
Well, so the good thing about Trenton is he's from Houston.
Right.
And he's in Houston. And so.
Right. So he didn't just come in every once in a while. He's around.
He's around.
Yeah. Well, he's one of our favorites, so I just like giving him a hard time. So. No, but it would have to be an interesting thing deciding. I mean, you've got a nice big humidor, but that said, you can't carry every cigar line that there is. So there's got to be a process involved for you in deciding exactly what you are going to carry. How do you make that? How do you make those choices?
Well, generally the cigar reps will come in and they'll say, "Hey, we've got something new. Why don't you try it?" And we will collectively smoke it together and judge its merits and decide whether or not it deserves a place inside of the
spot. Yeah.
In the humidor.
Yeah, but it's not one of those things like at the grocery store where it's like they sell you the shelf space and all of that type of stuff. Right?
No,
none of that stuff's going on in the cigar industry. Well, it's a great humidor. It's a walk-in. You've got a great stock and great array of things in there, including several that I haven't smoked, so I'll be back in after the show doing some collecting. But I think it's nice to know that there's a place that has that kind of selection with cigars and the kind of selection that you have with pipe tobacco. You've got hundreds of pipe tobaccos I've never even smelled.
The pipe tobacco is such a wonderful thing because I've walked in here with my pipe in hand and not knowing what I want. And you guys have offered me, here, put a pinch in your pipe and try it. You know, if you've got a little time, those kind of things. That's the kind of service that changes things, you know?
Right.
Have they ever actually said to you, put that in your pipe and smoke it?
I was wondering.
Not
the same
in so
thing.
Many words.
But it would be perfect. It would be a perfect opportunity to do that, right? At least you know where that saying came from. Well,
okay.
Well, it's a very impressive operation. Nice little place over here to sit and smoke if you like, and it's just got a very comfortable feel to it, which is what I like about it most. Which probably speaks to the the amount of time that you've been doing this. It's just nice and easy going and comfortable.
How long have you personally been working in the shop? This is a family business,
right?
It's
a family business. I've been off and on. Uh-huh. So I say that I grew up here because I came in and wiped down the counters and refilled the liquor. At that particular point in time, we had a full assortment of single barrel scotches, single malt whiskeys,
high-end tequilas. I remember when you guys were selling that out, actually, at the old location right over here. I remember that time. I remember walking in and you had that right up front. That was really nice.
So, probably from the age 11, 12, I came almost every day during the summer. And then in high school, I worked here. Of course, after high school, I went to college and joined the Marine Corps. And around 2011, my aunt, who was co-owner, was looking to retire. And we just could not see the business going to somebody who didn't understand the history, who wasn't as committed to the longevity and keeping it running the way that it had been run for the 50 years previous.
I think it's important. Heritage is an important thing. This is an industry. When you talk about Oliva Cigars celebrating their 135th year, with by the way, a terrific smoke. I sure hope you're going to have some of these in your stock. But it's just absolutely terrific. And this is an industry where age and heritage is important. And I think probably probably the same thing would be true of pipes as well, right? That there's there's a deep and rich history, and that's a part of what the whole thing is about.
There's a whole culture around it that we've kind of gotten into that as cigar smokers and pipe smokers, and you don't realize when you're new at this. I have friends that I'm thinking about getting into smoking pipes, and they come ask me because I smoke pipes as well. And just, my small amount of knowledge that I have on it, I try to help them come in and buy a pipe. But your staff and you know so much more about it. It's really interesting to come in and talk to you guys. And we've had a few conversations over the years.
I'm surprised, Ian, he lost his ash a moment ago, and it didn't make it all the way over to your shirt.
Well, the fan's blowing up.
I moved the fan.
Ian's something of a magnet for cigar ash. He seems to always get it get it on his shirt.
You will notice if I have a cigar with a long ash, I will actually start sitting like this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it makes a lot of sense.
And it'll always drop about halfway to the ashtray.
Yes. Yeah.
Speaking of sitting up, why don't you sit up and pour us a little bit of that Breckenridge there.
You're so bossy, but okay.
I know. I thought somebody needed to bump us in that direction. But I really am a little impatient to try it with this cigar.
Absolutely.
Yeah. This whiskey is from Breckenridge Distillery in Colorado.
No problem. And drag in.
There we go. We got a little
mini,
there.
Mini pop.
That'll work. This is a whiskey that is, or a bourbon that is finished in rum casks. And I am hoping that it will go really nicely with the cigar.
Well, you. Now you cleared the neck on this just to keep us all safe.
That's
so we didn't spill any.
As
we know, I can be a little fumble finger here.
Safety first. That's the way I operate.
I'm seeing a theme here, picking on me because the bottle that I brought, that didn't happen.
Right. But we'll take care of that. Ian is pretty skilled at this. So, we just like to make sure that no actual on the job accidents occur. So this is the Breckenridge. It is, like I said, it's a rum. It's finished in rum casks. And I don't know all that much more about it, except that I read an excellent review of it, which was one of the reasons I decided to pick it up.
Breckenridge, Colorado, of course, rum cask finish. It says blended bourbon whiskey finished in rum barrels with natural flavor added. So this
is fantastic.
Has no other information on it.
Right, it's really not, really doesn't tell us a lot, but I think it may speak volumes. I can tell you right away that on the nose, this is going to pair beautifully with this cigar if the nose
is... It has a little of that dark molasses on the nose.
Yep, and it's got
get caramel.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just some wonderful caramel notes and a little bit of maybe crisp apple. Is that what I'm getting in
yes,
there?
Yes, I can totally get that in the back of the mm-hmm. palate.
Yeah. Well,
what about maple syrup?
I go with maple syrup. I'd go, there's a slight chocolatiness to it if you let it linger and then the retrohale on it.
If this just had a slightly thicker mouthfeel, you could think of it on pancakes or waffles.
Yeah.
You know? It's got that much of a mapley a quality to it.
And that's Breckenridge.
I will tell you that I hit the sort of ignition point, if you will, on this cigar a while back. And it is now, I would say, leaning towards the more full side of medium to full. And it's just wonderful.
With this Breckenridge, it's awesome.
Mm, a really nice pairing. Ian, you're working on one of these as well, right?
Yeah, it brings out a little bit of mocha or chocolatiness, even almost a coffee, slight coffee kind of flavor out of the cigar.
Well, we have another whiskey that we'll be trying in our next segment, which is one that Trenton brought along. And so I'll let you tell us about that in the next segment. But Trenton,
I know nothing.
Oh, okay. Well, then we'll just
it
try
it. It was a gift.
We'll try it and we'll give it our basic review.
We'll learn all together.
Which is, you know, Ian's always good at the reviews on these because he has a tendency to say, whiskey good.
Yes, yeah, so I try to boil it down to the simplistic,
yeah,
if you will.
Trenton, 135 years of Oliva cigars. Did so Oliva began in Cuba,
yes,
correct?
Yep.
And there's obviously no more operations in Cuba. That you moved out. The company moved out completely at a certain point.
As did
most. Yeah,
I mean all cigar companies it's all state-owned now in Cuba.
Right.
So.
If you wanted to keep owning your company, you had to take it elsewhere. Yeah. Yeah. When the company relocated, did Oliva start making cigars again immediately, or was there a ramp-up period?
They kind of circled through Central America and then mm-hmm. ended up in Nicaragua. And, I mean, that's a whole nother story with the Sandinistas and the Contras. I mean, I think it was Gilberto, or it might have been one of our owners at one point was telling a story about he was supposed to go meet somebody, and the guy that he was going with, Gilberto couldn't make the meeting, and they ended up getting attacked by guerrillas and killed.
Mm.
So, I mean, it's crazy.
That's, now, crazy. Back in that day, it might have seemed, well, let me say it this way. If you were to start doing tobacco in Nicaragua now, it would seem almost like a no-brainer because that's where so much of the best tobacco is coming out of right now, and so many Nicaraguan brands are doing exceptionally well. I would say I smoke probably better than 75% of what I smoke now is cigars that have at least some Nicaraguan tobacco. It's just, it's a flavor profile that I've really kind of latched onto. But back then, that may not have seemed quite so obvious, was it? I mean, obviously you knew the soil was right for tobacco.
Well, and it's
but
really interesting because I got into the industry in 1998. And back then, Nicaragua wasn't what it is today. It was mostly Dominican and Honduran.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the cigars that people were smoking thought they were full flavor, full body. And now with the...
Now they'd be considered mild to medium. Right?
They would definitely be medium mm-hmm. because of all the Nicaraguan tobacco that's come out. So when the Olivas left Cuba, along with most other cigar makers, it was because of the communist regime that came in, and they had to go elsewhere, as did most other cigar makers. So they tested the waters in Nicaragua, Honduras, the Dominican, all over Central America, and the Olivas were very successful. And I mean, history shows that it has been a great move. Some of our heritage, Melanio.
Mm-hmm.
Melanio Oliva is where it all started, and that's our best seller now. The new Cigar Aficionado just rated the Figurado a 95.
Oh, that is unbelievable. Like, there are, you know,
they're stingy when it gets to the 90s, too. Well, they're real stingy with it.
Yeah, and cigar companies will put up, you know, placards in the humidor and run full ads if they get a 90.
Yep.
95s are rare, and I'll be honest with you, most of the 95s that I've seen in Cigar Aficionado through the years have been Cubans. It's even more rare for a non-Cuban cigar. I mean, if you score a 93, it's time to throw an office party because you're about to have a really good year. You know, a 95, that's just unheard of.
And we've been really blessed to have many Serie V and Milanios in the top 20 consistently over the years in Cigar Aficionado.
And we mentioned this earlier in the show, but you also have not jacked the prices up to 20 bucks on those because of it. I mean, if you look at some of the other cigars that have scored high that consistently, talking about the Padron Aniversarios and things that are in that line, those cigars are much more expensive. Their top of the line ones are, and yet your top of the line ones continue to remain really affordable. And I'm just so impressed with that.
And let's also talk consistency, because 2014, mm-hmm. the Milanio Figurado got number one cigar of the year. 7 years later, it just got rated a 95, and I mean, that's 7 years ago.
That's right. I don't even know how you make them consistent from one box to the next, much less over 7 years. I mean, that's very impressive.
Do you see the direct result of those ratings in your humidor?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So you try to anticipate it as well.
Right.
Because as soon as they score, usually in the top five or 10, people are rushing in to try and get it.
People are snapping them up.
I know our good friend Alan Denny worked for E.P. Carrillo mm-hmm. for a while, and when they got Cigar of the Year several years back, he said that it was just like,
night and day.
There was no way for them to keep up with the demand. Yeah. Everybody wanting to try it. So that's that doesn't surprise me. Yeah, usually when they name Cigar of the Year, if it's something I want to smoke, I go out and try to buy some immediately because I know they're going to be a little
gone
tougher
within
to find.
Hours.
And I'm going to guess the same thing could be true for the Melania coming out with the 95 rating. You guys got enough stock, Trenton?
We do.
All right, good to know.
This has come out, by the way, this is like picked up this beautiful cedar kind of finish to it that I'm absolutely loving, especially on the retro hails.
This is just a wonderful cigar. It really is. And it goes great with this Breckenridge. Just as Ian is fond of saying, they form like Voltron.
Yes.
They really, really work well together. All right, we're going to take a break. When we come back, it's time for the segment that, quite frankly, I don't really understand, but it's become the most talked about and popular segment on the show, and that is drinking news. So we'll do a little drinking news, we'll talk some more cigars, and we'll taste this. Tell me the name of that whiskey that you brought.
WB Saffel or Saffel?
WB Saffel. Let's go with Saffel, unless anybody knows differently. It's a great-looking label on this bottle. It just has that bourbon look to it.
I think if you're French, it's Saffel, but if it's Kentucky, Saffel.
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 Well, we'll try the Saffel when we come back. And also, your drinking news is next. It's Smoking and Toasting.
Awesome.
Right. Welcome back. It's Smoking and Toasting. We are live at the Briar Shop in Houston. And it sure is a great place to come and have a cigar, and this sure is a great cigar to have because it's a...
I didn't get a pop.
Yeah, we'll try that again. There we go.
Yeah, that's
so, you know, you always get two shots at making
I had to be. Yeah, I had to be a little more aggressive with
it. So Ian's going to pour this whiskey, but I wonder, should you maybe wait just a moment and pick up the ukulele?
Oh, you want me to go there? Okay, so I'm going to need a mic holder again.
Because you know what time it is. It's time for drinking news.
Drinking news, drinking news. Now it's time for drinking news. Drinking news, drinking news. Now it's time for drinking news. A Florida man with one arm said he had a gator for a pet. When I asked about his absent arm, he said,
I had to take my gator to the vet.
Drinking news, drinking news. Now it's time for drinking news.
Cheers, y'all. A reminder that Drinking News, this weirdly popular segment on the program, is...
It's because of the song.
I think it is. That has to be
It's all about the music.
It has to be it. So I'm just wondering, is it less popular when we use the alternate drinking news theme song?
Or the Chris Morris version?
The Chris Morris version?
You know, I don't know. That's a pretty good version.
It is a pretty good version.
It has kangaroos and fighting.
Anytime you're fighting a kangaroo.
Have you heard this?
I've not.
You know Chris, right?
Yeah.
Isn't that Chris?
Yeah. Yeah, well, everybody knows Chris.
Everybody knows Chris.
Isn't that a TV show? Everybody
Have you ever fired Chris?
I have not. Well, never had that opportunity.
Yeah. Don't worry. It'll happen. So drinking news is where we bring you a story that we believe to be true. It comes from at least a semi-reputable news agency. We try not to make these up or get them from places that are known for making up stories.
Well, if it's on the internet, it's true,
well,
right?
Exactly.
There's that.
Or if it's in Wikipedia, you know, because that's always accurate. But no, drinking news is where we bring you a story that is sometimes about drinking, but is always best enjoyed if you've been drinking. And today on Drinking News, we are going to take a break from our ongoing reporting on the legendary Florida man and his relatives from other states.
A large number of Drinking News stories start with a Florida man.
A Florida man, yeah. But in this case, we're going to bring you a story about actual drinking. And it's the best kind because it's celebrity drinking.
Celebrity drinking.
Staffers at Laurie's Prime Rib, a restaurant near the main strip in Las Vegas, were forced to throw out a babbling, barefoot Nicolas Cage this month after
surprise.
A drunken interaction with staff and customers. Footage that has been posted online shows the 57-year-old actor being escorted out of the restaurant after initially being mistaken for a homeless man. The star of Raising Arizona and Moonstruck was barefoot and dressed in leopard trousers and a black T-shirt.
He's going the Nick Nolte route now.
Which, you know, I don't know about you, but that's what I always wear when I'm going out.
Hey, do I know that homeless man?
Yeah. Cage was apparently sitting on a sofa inside Laurie's on September 13th, rambling incoherently after downing shots of tequila and 1980 Macallan whiskey, which are always a good idea to mix, by the way. An eyewitness claimed that the star, who won an Oscar for his portrayal of an alcoholic in Leaving Las Vegas, was clearly intoxicated and was yelling at people. The source said, quote, "We were at the bar at Lowry's when we noticed that what we first thought was a homeless man was completely drunk and being rowdy. To our shock, it turned out to be Nicolas Cage. He was completely smashed and was getting into a bit of a fight with the staff." In a clip that was posted on the internet, Cage can be seen in the leopard print trousers, actually putting on a pair of sandals and walking out the door. He then appears to try to walk back into the venue, and a female member of the staff stands in front of him, blocking the way. Cage, of course, is the actor who is once quoted as saying, "I am not a demon. I am a lizard, a shark, a heat-seeking panther. I want to be Bob Denver on acid playing the accordion."
Man, I wish I had said that.
It's not too late.
I'm not saying that Cage is eccentric, but let's do remember that he has a son that he named Kal-El, which is Superman's birth name.
There's a series on YouTube. A guy put up a series of things of what Nicolas Cage spends his money on, because he's apparently just that weird.
Yes. No word, by the way, on whether Kal-El showed up to help his dad get home. Reporting from Crazy Town, USA, my name is Cruz, and that is your
Drinking News. Do we have a picture?
We do.
Now it's time for a picture of Drinking News. I'm going to sing this song while
Adam
puts this up. That is fantastic.
Adam will actually post this on the show, so if you're watching the YouTube feed, you'll see it. But we're going to show it to the camera here since we can't put it.
Who says you can't wear leopards?
And with that, Drinking News.
Yes.
Drinking News. Now it's time for Drinking News. Drinking News. Drinking News. That was time for Drinking News.
Cheers, y'all. So now you understand why it's the most popular segment on the show. We can talk about cigars and whiskey and stuff all day, but boy, show a picture of Nicolas Cage in some leopard pants.
Oh, that is fantastic. I love how well he clashes with that couch.
I know. It's really
its own thing.
Something out of nature.
It really is a wonderful thing. I'm not sure what kind of nature.
No.
It's Smoking and Toasting. We're all about craft beer, fine spirits, and hand-rolled cigars. This is show number 253, which has us officially halfway to 300.
I've done the math. That's about right.
Thank you for doing that. We are here with Trenton from Oliva, smoking Oliva's new cigar, and we are at the Briar Shop. Bill is here with us from the Briar Shop, and we're actually about to taste a whiskey that Trenton brought with him, but knows.
What do you mean by about to?
Oh, you're ahead
going
of me.
Going right here. In.
I do research, man.
So, Ian, since you have done the most research on this, let's go to you for first reactions.
So first off, on the nose, there's this beautiful like caramel and cinnamon thing going on. When
yes,
you take a sip
cinnamon.
Of this, there is malt and fig and dark fruit in the background, and then this great kind of wonderful saltiness, and then that cinnamon hits the back of the palate.
Mm, yes, it does. A lot
just
of cinnamon.
And just finishes off in the most beautiful way.
So this is really hard, because I was thinking it would be tough to top the first whiskey, the Breckenridge, but this is awfully good.
This is fantastic on its own by itself, mm-hmm. just like this. Bill, how do you feel about the whiskey?
It's awesome. It's good.
So this was given to me by a good friend of mine, Scott, grew up or lived with him in Indianapolis for a long time. And every now and then he just sends me a bottle of bourbon. He's a bourbon collector. And we haven't seen each other in person in a long time. So he's like, you know what? We need to drink this. We need to do a FaceTime or something, catch up. Mm-hmm. And so I need to save some of this stuff.
It raises, I think, a really pertinent question. Why don't I have friends that send me bourbon?
Why don't you?
Why don't I have friends that send me bourbon? Well, Scott in Indianapolis, thank you.
This well, is... now he's in North Carolina.
Oh, well.
In North Carolina.
He's moving up in the world.
He is. So, thank you, Scott.
Yeah. Scott, this is really good. Now, I will say, it doesn't go badly with the cigar, but the Breckenridge was like... feels like it would win the whiskey sniff.
Well, this whiskey is really sweet and smooth up front, and then has this minerality and cinnamon aftertaste to it that I think that minerality is what's not blending with the cigar quite as well. However, it is pretty outstanding.
It's still pretty good, yeah. And it's spicier also than the first
whiskey. So what, that's 107 proof.
What year was Oliva started?
135 years ago.
1886, and the interesting thing...
So this is in 1889.
89, 3 years apart.
After 20 years in the employ of his contemporaries, W.B.
Saffel,
opened a distillery of his own. So this heritage goes back to within 3 years of...
Of Oliva's
Melanio.
Yeah,
that's so pretty amazing.
That's just... And the interesting thing was, I don't remember if it was on the bottle or online where we read it, but he was a teenager when he started messing around with mixing,
distilling and making whiskey. Yeah.
So a lot of, like Bill said, he was a kid when he came in here, 11, 12 years old, wiping down the counters. That's just an industry of passion.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
yes.
There's so many similarities between the whiskey industry and the cigar industry. And it is passion. It's family. It's just ingrained into you. From birth, basically.
That was one of the things when we had a chance to go to Honduras and visit the folks there
at Aladino. That was a great trip.
You got a great sense of the family, mm-hmm. and I'm sure that's no different with Oliva as well. You are smoking that all the way to the nub. And that to me is always the sign of a good cigar.
That
when you can
fantastic.
Smoke it down
I don't wanna,
that
I don't,
far and you don't,
I don't
wanna
want
let
it
go.
End.
Yeah.
You just don't
want to
give it up.
It's really,
I've
really
still got
good.
About another 5 minutes, I think.
Why did a Rick Astley song just pop into my mind?
Oh my God. What?
You Rickrolled yourself.
I Rickrolled myself. That's horrible.
Can you name the song?
Never gonna give you up.
Oh, there you go.
Never gonna let you down. It's not his only song, you know, but it's the one
it
most likely.
Been.
It's the one most likely to be Rickrolled.
That should be a segment too.
I will say though that this, I probably have enjoyed this cigar more than anything that I've smoked in a very long time.
This is
it's
fantastic.
Just absolutely wonderful. Goes with this. Really goes with the Breckenridge. And I'm curious to see, while I still have a little bit of it left, Ian, how it will go with our stout. Here because we have one more thing to taste, and that is the
do
other
you want me to go ahead and pop
company.
That open now?
Let's do it. The Deep Orbit Centaurus Imperial Stout with vanilla, figs, almonds, and cinnamon. The Other Half Brewing Company is in Brooklyn, New York, and the label on this, I actually had to look this beer up on the internet to see what the label said, because it is hard. The letters are really difficult to see against the sort of cosmic-looking background. But I have a feeling we're going to be enjoying this. Just the description on the bottle alone is enough to get me pretty excited about trying it.
Thank you.
Passing those around here. I'm really excited to see how this goes with the bit of this cigar that I have left. So that's why I'm rushing us a little to try it here. Ian, thank you for doing the pouring duties.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate it. This I'm noticing when you pour this out, it pours like motor oil.
Yep. I don't see any chunks in it though.
No. Well, I tried. I know you enjoy the chewy Imperial stouts.
We tried. I can't remember what it was, but we tried one at the at my brew club meeting recently that had so much chunks in it. It was even hard for me to. To deal with.
It's too chunky for you, it's too chunky.
It was pretty bad.
Wow. Campbell's chunky beer.
Wow.
It was it was an experience more than anything.
So this, I will just say, it's wonderful. It starts with big coffee, but it ends with this cinnamon cookie kind of vibe to it, almost like a snickerdoodle.
I can go with that. It has a in the aftertaste, it has almost that powdered sugar.
Yeah.
Kind of, you know, that
I flavor. Was thinking brown sugar.
Brown sugar, yeah.
You can definitely get the fig. If you let it rest on the palate for a minute, you'll go, yeah, really ripe fig.
Yep.
Wow. That's impressive. And yes, it does go quite nicely.
That is beautiful.
Is there any information on the bottle here? What does it say? Other half, Imperial Stout with vanilla, figs, almonds, and cinnamon. I don't get a whole lot of almond in there. I wasn't picking up a whole lot on that.
No.
And that's it. That's all the information they have on here.
And it's really hard to even read the name of the beer on that cosmic background. Like I said, I had to look it up on the internet to make sure I was getting it right. But it's really, really wonderful. We've had some beers from Other Half on the show before, and they've all been very complex like this one is. A lot of different flavors. Of course, what they put into it is
what none of us has said is that it comes across particularly boozy, because it doesn't really come across particularly boozy. However,
does it say what the alcohol percentage is?
Are you ready for it?
Tell me.
12.
16.9.
16. Is that one of the biggest we've ever had on the show? Have we had
something pretty big? Well, we've had the 120 minute, which I think was at 18.
Yeah.
We've had a few others that were approaching that, but that's pretty big. That's probably one of the biggest we've had on the show.
It's really terrific, though. It just doesn't come across nearly that boozy.
No, it doesn't. It's sweet. It's definitely sticky, and it's not light on the palate. It definitely has a big, round, full mouthfeel to it as well.
This beer is not designed to be light on the palate.
It's really pretty wonderful. Now I'm going to go back to the whiskeys, which is something we like to do after these bigger beers.
I'm searching for almond. I'm not really getting almond out of there, but those figs are huge.
A little
is there
a little bit of nuttiness there?
I'm not.
No,
it could be the cigar masking it a little bit too.
I don't know if you've tried this or not, but that waffle, however we're saying
yes.
If you cut it just a little bit with water, mm-hmm. it really changes
it. Opens it up.
Yeah.
Well, I just went back to it after the beer, and I'm getting a real chocolatey note that I don't know that I noticed before. Ian, I'm waiting on your thoughts.
That maybe reminds me, a guy in a cigar shop one time just had some candy, and then he smoked a cigar, and he's like, yeah, I'm getting a lot of chocolate on this. I go, might have been the candy bar you just ate.
could have had something to do with it.
That right? Might have been the candy bar you just ate.
Well, and that's one of the reasons that, you know, different cigars will smoke differently at different times, depending on what you had for dinner.
Yep.
You know, one of the things for people that eat red meat, if you have a really good steak, or maybe a nice piece of lamb, and then you go for a cigar afterwards, you will get a different experience than what you get just smoking it, you know, before dinner.
Oh, absolutely. Everything you've had on your palate affects everything else on your palate.
Mm-hmm.
But that's part of the fun of mixing and matching, too, and seeing what goes together and what doesn't. Because you might have two great things. Like, for instance, that whiskey you brought is fantastic. This cigar is fantastic. But they don't go together as well as the previous whiskey and the cigar.
Go back to the Breckenridge after you have a drink.
I don't have a Breckenridge.
Well, I think
I may have drank mine.
We can remedy that, I believe. You do have a Breckenridge. Well, You have what may have been Breckenridge.
It's
the remnants.
It's the remnants of the Breckenridge.
But I'll be interested to see what you think, Ian, if you go back to the Breckenridge after this, because it's different.
Need more hands.
And here I thought you felt so untethered with that wireless mic.
Trenton with the save.
I think that's the only reason you guys asked me here.
Yeah, it
to hold
is.
The
You're
mic.
Wonderful mic holder.
Oh, you know, back in the 90s, one of my bands used to play with this band from New Orleans all the time. They were called Rutabaga. And it was a duet. It was a guy on drums and a girl on bass, and that was the whole band, you know. And she used a bunch of effects to make it sound more guitar-like and stuff. A little opposite of what White Stripes kind of did. But the guy on the bass always cracked me up because he'd play drums. He had a harmonica thing around his neck, you know, so he could play harmonica when
the
he needed
Bob
it.
Dylan.
But he also would wear this bicycle helmet that he had affixed a gooseneck to for his vocal mic.
Yeah. So they were.
I think that's what I need for this show. This is the bicycle helmet, you know, just to keep me safe, and then a gooseneck for my mic, and then I have a hands free.
Or go-go gadget arm.
Go-go gadget arm.
Well. So take a drink of the other half stout, and then go back to the Breckenridge and tell me what you find.
The other half stout.
I'm being bossy, but it's
you are
direction.
Being very bossy. It is.
It's
it is
direction
though.
That you will like.
Okay, now go back to. Now go back.
Now walk like an Egyptian. All right. Wow.
Yeah.
It gets fruity.
Mm-hmm.
It gets oddly fruity.
Some of that like dark fruit notes coming through there. Now I haven't gone back to the stout.
The chocolate in that one is a little more evident too now after I've done that.
These are great tastes that taste great together.
And it brings out coffee in the stout substantially.
Yes, it does. I'm pretty impressed with both of these whiskeys, and of course this stout is just terrific. I wonder if it's at 16%. Is it more potent than the whiskeys? It's damn close.
It's standing up there with it.
Yeah,
that's for sure.
Well. I have to say, Trenton, this cigar has been a wonderful experience.
I smoked it down to where it was going to burn my lips. And
I'm getting close here.
And you're holding that ash very well.
Well, that's only because I'm not sitting directly next to Ian.
The ash magnet
would have pulled this away.
Ashes already. Like to fall on me.
All right, we're going to take a break and be back with our final segment. We're live at a wonderful establishment that's been open in Houston, Texas, for a very long time, called the Briar Shop, and before we leave today, I will be smelling pipe tobaccos, because that's one of the things you have to do.
That's one of the joys of this place.
It really is. All right, we'll be right back. It's Smoking and Toasting, show number 200, and what did I say, 53? Something
halfway
like
to 300. Just divide it in half, 253.
We'll be right back.
Glad you're not teaching my daughter math.
Welcome back. It's Smoking and Toasting. We want to thank Bill and the entire staff of the Briar Shop for hosting us here today and allowing us to do the show in their lovely little seating area here. A great place to come and smoke a cigar or a pipe, for that matter. And I noticed, by the way, when we came in, I think one of the guys behind the counter was smoking a cigar and the other was smoking a pipe. So, you know, it's all well represented.
They know what they're doing.
And they know what they're doing. They really do know a lot about pipe tobacco. And that's... You know, whenever I have a pipe question, I always call you because you're the pipe guy that I know that knows the most. But these guys are working with this stuff every day. They're about as knowledgeable, I think, as you can get.
Well, they get to be here and do research as well, so they get to try out all the different things, and so they can experience and let you know what it's all about.
Yeah, that's
right. So if you ask them about a specific cigar profile, they can guide you in the right direction, or a specific tobacco for your pipe and a sort of profile.
What you like, and they'll direct you to new things to try. Trenton Smith from Oliva has been our special guest today. It really was so awesome to be able to smoke this new cigar, which is coming out. You don't have a date in October.
We don't have a date.
But it's coming in October.
Yep.
And it'll be at a tobacconist near you. The Briar Shop will have some, so come and pick them clean, because they won't last long. You want to go in on a box, Ian?
I'm in on a box.
Okay, cool. Yeah, this is definitely worthwhile. I feel like Oliva is, I mean, you guys are almost at your peak here. What with the kind of ratings you guys have been getting consistently in the cigar magazines, with a recent 95 for the Serie V Milano, and now with this cigar, like, where do you guys even go from here?
You know, it's just such a blessing to be able to work for a company that has resources. Jay Cortez has just put their heart and soul into Oliva and getting us everything that we need, a new factory, a box factory, marketing stuff. I mean, it's just incredible. We really haven't gone through the back order issues that a lot of companies have.
Your stuff is very consistently available.
And it's, right. I mean, we really don't have many back orders right now. And that is just a testimonial to our management and our everybody in the factory coordinating together. I mean, it's just been awesome. I mean, you know, I don't want to say it's been awesome going through COVID, but it's been awesome seeing how our company has reacted.
Has responded
and
to
it's
it.
Been
yeah.
really incredible seeing Absolutely just right. the logistics of getting everything in place so that we don't get behind.
So aside from the obvious 135 years, how long does it take for a cigar like this to come out from inception?
From planting to
hey, we're going to do a blend like this to having it out on the market.
A cigar like this, yes. 135 years.
Well, I mean, that's the obvious one.
That's a great
answer. Just a regular cigar could take 2 years mm-hmm. from planting to the aging of the tobacco to, the, I mean, you've got to age the tobacco, then you make the cigar, then you have to age the cigar. I mean, it just depends on the tobacco.
It takes time.
But it's a lot of
it's
time.
It's a patient industry.
And so many hands touch
yes.
this product in the manufacturing of it, from the time that it's put in, the seeds put in the ground, to the time that it's boxed to the retailers.
Right.
By the time it gets to the consumer, so many people have had a role in bringing this product to the consumer.
We talked about this after we visited Aladino in Honduras and saw what was involved in the operation, from the planning mm-hmm. to the growing, to the harvesting, to all the things that you talked
to
about,
the rolling,
curing,
to the aging.
And we came away amazed that you can buy a cigar for $10 with as many people as
or
have
less
to be involved,
yeah.
or less yeah,
yeah. Yep.
With as many people as have to be involved in that whole process of bringing it to market and getting it to the shelf at a place like the Briar Shop.
And that was the point. It was Ilusión put out the 300 monos.
Mm-hmm.
That
300
was,
hands.
That's what that was about. Apparently it's supposed to be 300 hands have touched yeah. that cigar before
it's
it got
amazing.
To you.
And that's
amazing.
That's not an exaggeration.
That's
and,
absolutely amazing.
And the last hands to touch it, which are yours when you smoke it, are the people who get the benefit of those other 300.
Yes,
sure.
yes.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Thank you so much
yeah.
for bringing
oh,
this
my
on.
Pleasure, man.
Thank you. Yeah, this has been a pleasure. We'll be buying more of these. And so once again, as we're fond of saying, smoking and toasting directly affects sales.
That's right. You got at least a couple boxes sold
yeah,
here.
Right. Exactly. So, Trenton, thank you. You know, you're always welcome here,
thank
but
you
it's
guys.
Always a pleasure to have you on the show. And you have a tendency to come in and just be very affable and friendly, not like that Alan Denny guy or Chris Hart or any of those guys who come on and cause such trouble. We want to say thanks again to Bill and the staff here at the Briar Shop. Come and buy some cigars and some pipe tobacco from these guys. It's more than just going shopping. It's coming in and being able to share a really cool experience and talk tobacco with these
and
guys.
And part of the culture, even.
Absolutely. And one of the things I love about when we do a show at a place like this is getting to see guys that are coming in and buying something, getting to see them walk out with that little package of cigars in their hand
and
this
smile on
happy
face.
Smile
so excited.
On their face. It's such
those
a wonderful
cigars are
thing.
Going to a fun place.
Yep, absolutely.
Look at the awesome burn on this, by the way.
And look how far I've got this one down to the nub. That's just amazing. Thank you for enjoying Smoking and Toasting with us. We will be back again with you next Thursday live. And, of course, you can always find our shows on all of the podcast networks and at YouTube, which is a good place to check out the show. Go watch us on YouTube. Thanks to Adam on the Wheels of Steel. And thank you again for enjoying Smoking and Toasting with us. We appreciate it, and we appreciate you. And as we like to say, cheers,
y'all.
Cheers.